Today was a pretty hardcore day. I got out on the tennis court. I worked for a couple of hours. Then Mike Bryan stopped by and wanted to hit a little. And for those of you who don't know who Mike Bryan is, he is, along with his brother, the greatest doubles player of all time when it comes to tennis. He has spent 454 weeks at number one, I believe it is. 1,018 match wins, 114 titles, 16 Grand Slams, 4 or 5 mixed double Grand Slams, Olympic gold medal. I mean, the list is just ridiculous. He's a good friend of mine. I was traveling with him and his brother for a year last year on the ATP tour, working with them. And today was the first day I'd hit with him in a really long time. And it just brought home a few things to me about focus and about work and about hard work and about how it's really possible to do anything you put your mind to, I think. Because today I got to do this. With the greatest doubles player of all time. The fact that I've played tennis for 3.5 or 4 years and, you know, have really focused hard on it and really worked towards, well, I don't know whether there was really a goal there, but to be able to do that and operate on that level, nowhere near him, of course. I'm hanging on for dear life. Let's be very, very clear about that. I am hanging on for dear life when I hit with him. But to be able to go out there and hit the ball and give him a workout, that's pretty huge. That's like me being like 15 years old and going out and playing with John Coltrane or something. It's you know, two people on two very different levels. But having that will and that strength, that fitness especially, that's a huge part of it, to hang in there, even though I was absolutely fucking exhausted by the time we were hitting. But hung in there for a little while, striped the ball pretty well, and it was fun. But it really hammered home how important it is to have a work ethic when you want to achieve something. And there's no way around it. There's just no way around work. One of the few things I think we have total control over is how hard we want to push ourselves to work towards something, to achieve something, to accomplish something, to find happiness with something. It's something really special. It's something I've worked super hard on my entire life, especially through music, developing that kind of work ethic and that will to carry on, I guess, is what it comes down to. You know, it's so easy, I think, to get disheartened or disillusioned with something and not stick with it because there's an easier way out and that doesn't involve work. I think that's maybe the point I'm trying to get to. It's a lot easier to not do the work and maybe change the path and meander through life, kind of changing from one thing to the other, and never quite pushing yourself to your potential, because we all have potential. I think we're all born with just an incredible amount of potential, and it's our responsibility to unlock that potential and figure out how we can best channel our work ethic and our will to succeed and our search for happiness and channel that into something. For me, it's obviously been music predominantly my entire life, and more recently it's been tennis. And when I get to do things like this again, you know, I was on the road with those guys for a year, doing that every day. That was an amazing experience and an incredible amount of fun at times. Very, very hard work, but an incredible amount of fun at times. And just kind of hitting today with Mike reminded me of that and reminded me there is more to life than music, number one, and to have a balance. You know, I'm talking to Dusan as well. Mike was working with Dusan Vemic, who is Novak Djokovic's coach. He was there on court with us and he was giving me a few tips, which is awesome. That's always fun. He's an amazing guy, very calm, very centered, very knowledgeable, great player, like ex-professional player, now a great coach. And, you know, just being around people like that who have that work ethic and they've found a way to channel it. And with Mike, he has this work ethic and he found a way to channel it into his professional career and be the greatest of all time. And with Dusan, I think on a similar level, it is found a way to channel that and be able to impart that knowledge and to improve other people's lives through his kind of stillness and calmness and observance of what they're doing and very subtle. That's what I like about Dusan, I think. The limited amount of time I've been around him is it's subtle. He makes great coaches and great teachers, I think, make subtle adjustments. They don't try and fill you. Christian Straka, my coach, is very good like that. He's not trying to change the way I hit the forehand or the backhand completely. He's not trying to make massive changes in the way I play. He's trying to add small keys, one at a time, and being aware of when I get that, when I get it, and when it's time to move on to the next thing and add another level or another layer to the process. So I think good coaches and good teachers are really good at that. And I think Christian, I think Dusan are two people that really excel in that area. So just really good being around those guys today, and reminded me how important all of that stuff is for me and for my process. And when I talk to you guys, and when I teach, and when I perform, and when I get down, you know, when I have doubt, really good to be reminded of how strong we are as human beings, no matter how much on a high we are or whether we're at a low point. It's good to be reminded of how strong we are. And it was nice to see how far I'd come as a tennis player and to be able to measure that a little bit and to feel good about what I was doing hitting with Mike and know that, yes, I was hanging on for dear life, but I was hanging in there. Here's one way to look at it. You know, Mike is just on such another legendary level that when we hit together, he can practice and he can work on things and he can make minor adjustments, and he has that timing and that flow and that sense of focus and experience while he's playing. Me, on the other side of the net, I'm just hanging on for dear life. There's no way I can work on things and develop things in my game. I'm just trying to stay in there and keep the ball in play and make sure it goes back over the net and lands somewhere close to Mike. Or if he wants to run, then trying to make it cross court down the line or whatever the exercise is. So really important also to know who you're around and when it's time to work on things and when it's time not to work on things. You know what I mean? I think you could transfer that over to a gig. If you're on a really high pressure gig where you have to be paying attention to a lot of different things and you're not like 100% in your comfort zone, then maybe that's not the greatest time to be working on the latest melodic minor lick or something that you might have just transcribed. So it's all about context, you know? So that reminded me, like, yes, I very much turn into a utility kind of tennis player at this point when there's somebody so great on the other side of the net and they need a workout, you know, and they need a hitting partner and they need someone to keep the ball in play. I'm not trying to beat him or even attempt to beat him at all. I'm trying to play with him instead of competing against him. So it was a lot of learning going on today. And that, and I'm telling you, I'm exhausted. Like, I did an hour of footwork drills before that. Kind of wish I hadn't done that because I'd have been in way better shape to hit with Mike. I did like an hour of footwork drills. I served like 300 balls. My right shoulder was like falling apart when I was hitting with Mike. But all good. And good to not be sick again. Good to get an idea of where my fitness is at, what I need to work on this week in the gym. And it was really, really useful to do that today for tennis, for fitness, for health, and for music. Because now I am utterly shattered. It is 9:05. Haven't practiced today. I've been running around and that and therapy early on. Hey, it's Monday morning. Of course, I'm going to therapy. So I did therapy, went straight to the court. We trained for almost 4 hours, I think. That was a big day. Then I have to go shopping. I needed a kettle. Like, this is random stuff, you know. I have emails to send, all that stuff. So now I'm still up, which is great. And I'm ready to get to my base and to work. And it was just so motivating. As exhausted as I am right now, that whole situation today just motivated me to get right into the zone, find my flow, pick up my bass, put some strings on right now, and get back to work with my music. First note of the day. Okay, quick side note before we get into the bass element of today's vlog. Please don't be abusive and swearing in the comments on this channel. It's not cool. I don't know, I don't have the name in front of me. I can't remember exactly who it was, but I noticed when I talked yesterday about the Ron really, whoever that guy was that made the comment that really wasn't that nice, and I addressed it and that whole thing in yesterday's vlog. Don't retaliate by being abusive. That's really, really not nice. You way more positive things that you could be doing with your life, and we should just be kind to other people. That's huge. No matter what they're saying towards you, be in control of what you can be in control of, which is the only thing that you can be in control of, which is your reaction. Like I've said before, you can't control them. You can't control what they say. Doesn't matter if you agree or disagree with it. if you want to respond, do it kindly. Be kind to them. You never know. That person, when they left that comment, might have just been having a really bad day. Something might not be right in their life. They might actually need help, and they might be reaching out in not the greatest of ways. You know, that's, you know, being abusive and leaving shitty comments is not a great way of asking for help, but that might be what it is. So give people the benefit of the doubt. Be kind to other people, and always be trying to better somebody else's life rather than shouting and swearing in the comments. So I would really, really appreciate it if we kept it positive. You know, I'm not going to delete comments. I'm not going to hide things. I'm going to leave everything up there. I'm not a fan of controlling the conversation and you're taking things out. There are going to be spaces that things won't make sense. I'm a big fan of leaving the discussion open. But please don't be abusive on the channel. That's just the one thing I ask you. Be kind to everyone. Respond in kind to everyone, no matter what they're saying to you. You know, like I said, you never know. They might just be in need of help. And it's the hard, trust me, it is the hardest thing in the world to ask for help. It is one of the toughest things we can do as human beings. We have to open up. We have to break down all our defenses and then ask for help. And that is a really tough thing to do. So it's way healthier to give someone the benefit of the doubt. And even if perhaps you think they don't deserve it, you also have another choice. You cannot reply. But being abusive and swearing and shouting, even if it's in defense of me, or you agree with me, you disagree with them, or you agree with them, you disagree with me, it's not cool. And there are just so many better things you can be doing with your time and your energy. So please keep it nice, keep it clean, keep it kind. You know, I swear a little bit in the vlog. You heard me say shit and fuck whatever else. I'm not directing that at anyone, you know. Just part of my vocabulary, and it's not particularly intelligent, and it comes out once in a while, and I'm not a big fan of it when I do swear, but it's just me and who I am. So please don't shout and scream, please don't be abusive, and please be kind as you possibly can to everyone around you. Really important. Okay, public service announcement is over, and I get to share with you one of the favorite parts of my day, and just sitting down with my bass and figuring out what I'm gonna play. No idea what I'm gonna play. But I'm searching for something, that's for sure. That's always important. Played that root motion before, but never with that rhythm. And I'm already hearing the percussion that I want to put with it. So I have loopers. Okay, I can get rid of that. That was the Ed Sheeran thing. I have loopers full of stuff. I want to keep that because that's a new idea I'm working on. So, that was it, right? I think that was it. So let's get that in the looper. I always dial the looper in. I'm using the Ditto X2 right now. I always dial it in with the when I'm making a loop with the volume pointing straight up at 12 o'clock. I don't know if that's something you should do. Just something that works for me. And I always notice that if it's down around 9 o'clock and I put the loop in, it's way lower when I go to loop it than it was coming out of the amp. So maybe the 12 o'clock position, maybe somebody can help me with that and tell me if that's right or not. The 12 o'clock position seems to be like a true representation of what's going on with the amp for the most part. Let's hope I remember our little idea here. Get my tap tempo on the delay. And I'm going to turn it up pretty loud, maybe max out the level of the effect. And just one hit with that long trail gives me some percussion in there.
Mm-hmm.
can turn the delay off. And already we have kind of a vibe going on here. It's kind of 9:30. You gotta turn the room sound down just a little bit. Always important to remember to turn the effect level down and the feedback back down again after I put that long trailed percussive thing in there. These are the first things I'm playing today in terms of my practice. I'm not fully warmed up, and as I'm playing that, I'm feeling like, okay, perhaps that's not the best approach to be taking right now in terms of where my fingers are at. Didn't feel loose, didn't feel natural, although the musical ideas are sort of starting to flow, there was definitely a little bit of a disconnect there for me. So this is what happens. I have this idea, I like this idea. It's the kind of thing that when I'm improvising on one of these solo concerts, it's that kind of thing that I want to come up with, something that's kind of simple and open, but grooving, and I can put some percussion in there, and you know, why not get a lower bass line in there? There we go. So that is what's feeling good right now, is to play a bass line and kind of work my chops into shape and warm them up playing in the lower register of the instrument. And that's, you know, that happens all the time. Sometimes it's up high, sometimes it's down low. Really doesn't matter. Just as long as I'm conscious of what feels comfortable and I'm conscious of my time and my sound and the timing, like just the fit. I went like that as I was hitting a forehand. That's so important in tennis to feel the rhythm and to feel the timing of the ball. I learned recently, my best friend Antonio, his wife Diane, great skier, and we went skiing one day. You can see it in the vlog. We drove down to Italy from Switzerland, and she put this thing as we were coming down and kind of carving down the hill. She said, have a song in mind, right? When you for the rhythm of the skis, like this. So you make your turn with the rhythm of the song. And I came up with, I don't know why I thought of this song. Hadn't listened to it in years. And you know, it's not a massive song for me or anything. I just, what would you do if I sang out of tune? Would you stand up and walk out on me? I was singing it a little bit slower, so it was like, what would you do if I sang? And I was kind of carving down the mountain like that. It was an awesome key. That's what I was talking about earlier on with the tennis thing about great coaches and great teachers. They add little keys and just little things to your process. And you know, that one saved my day. I mean, don't get me wrong. I ate it, especially on the last run down. And that might have been the only time I ate it. It was the last run down the mountain before we left. I did eat it, like, pretty bad. All still intact, all good. But that really helped. That really made it fun for the. And that was, she said that like super early on when we were going, and really cool. I think I thanked her for that. If I didn't, thanks, Diane. but it made the whole day really fun. That one little key. So exactly the same for tennis, for skiing, for the bass, whatever it is. Even if I go for a walk, I want to kind of get in a nice rhythm and feel like I'm kind of trucking down the pavement, you know, down the sidewalk, and feel comfortable and relaxed and kind of in flow. That's always what I'm looking for. So today, and I will say, this is interesting as well, as I turn the amp down, because it's a little bit late in the apartment, I don't want to kill my neighbors here, as I turn the amp down and start to play in the low register, I do miss that feedback from that information that the instrument is giving me and pushing through my fingers and into my ears, like the kind of the touch. It's nice to play at a proper volume, at maybe a stage volume, to really know what's going on with the instrument. So that's just something, you know, I'm thinking of right now, and kind of obviously wish I could play a little louder and get some feedback from the instrument. Kind of weird playing soft. Not weird playing soft in the context of a band. Like, playing soft with intensity is an art, actually, and something we should all be able to do. But just in general, playing, having to practice and play soft in an apartment, not such a great thing. But like I've said before, something I've dealt with my entire career. Lived in apartments in New York, lived in apartments in Los Angeles, and you know what? At the end of the day, it's not a bad problem to have. Trust me, we can still do a lot of damage. If we were saxophone players, like, you know, Bob Reynolds, Justin Vasquez, like everyone's been through it. Like, all my friends who are saxophone players, like, living in an apartment and trying to practice, that instrument is loud. There's no mute for it. There are, but there's not one that's really that effective. And I think Justin had a whisper room at some point that still didn't, like, shut down the noise enough to practice in an apartment. Anyway, getting off track here. I'm going to get back to working on my low-end chops here and getting my fingers in shape and continue practicing for the next couple of hours. Today's vlog is done. I will see you guys tomorrow.